Hello students, here we are going to start our third chapter from geography, that is our changing earth. These are the glossary words that you have to write down in FNB. First word is endogenic forces. The forces that act in the interior of the earth are called endogenic forces. Second, exogenic forces, the forces that act on the surface of the earth are called as exogenic forces. Third one, earthquake, the vibration caused by the movement of the lithospheric plates are called as earthquake. Next one, focus, the place in the crust where the movements start is called as focus. Epicenter, the place on the surface above the focus is called as epicenter. Next one is weathering. The breaking up of rock on the earth's surface is known as weathering. Erosion, the wearing away of the landscape by different agents like water, wind and ice is called as erosion. Waterfall, a place where a river or stream falls from a high place, for example, over cliff or rock is known as waterfall. Meander, large bends by the twisting and turning of a river while entering a plain are known as meander. Next you are having floodplains. Floodplains are areas where fine soils and other material get deposited during floods. These are very fertile. Usually alluvial soil are found in this kind of plains. Levees, the raised bank of river is known as levees. Distributary, as the river approaches the sea, the speed of the flowing water decreases and the river begins to break up into a number of streams called distributaries. Next you are having delta. Delta, it is a triangular area of land where a river has split into many smaller rivers before entering the sea. Sea caves. Sea caves are hollow-like caves formed on the rocks. Next you are having sea arches. When the cavities become very big, only the roof of the caves remains, that is known as sea arches. Stacks, further erosion break the roof and only wall-like feature remain. These features are called as stacks. Sea cliffs, the steep rocky coast rising almost vertically above the sea water is called as sea cliff. Beaches, the sea waves deposit sediments along the shores to form beaches. Mushroom rocks. In deserts, rocks in shape of mushrooms are very common. These are called as mushroom rocks. Next you are having sand dunes. In desert, when the wind stops blowing, the sand falls and gets deposited in low hill-like structure known as sand dunes. Loess, when very fine and light grains of sand gets deposited in large area, it is called as loess. So these are the glossary words which you have to write down in FNB after writing down the chapter heading. These are the topics that we are going to learn in this chapter. The first topic is the lithosphere. Almost a small portion of this we have learned in very first chapter. In detail we will learn in this chapter. Then the major landforms. Then works of river, sea waves, ice and wind. That we are going. So here we start our third chapter, that is our changing earth, from your textbook. You can see the lithosphere is broken into a number of plates known as the lithospheric plates. So there are seven plates which are known as lithospheric plates. You will be surprised to know that these plates move around very slowly, just a few millimeters each year. So we cannot feel that movement because that is moving a few millimeter each year. So this movement is not felt by us while it's moving. This is because of the movement of the molten magma inside the earth. Now why it is moving the lithospheric plates? Why? What is the reason behind the movement? Because of the molten magma that moves inside the earth. For that reason, it is moving. The molten magma inside the earth moves in a circular manner as shown in the activity. So you can see over here this activity. From here only you can understand. Conduct this at your home if it is possible. Take a small colored paper palette and put it in a beaker half filled with water. Place the beaker on a tripod stand and heat it. As the water warms up, you will observe that the paper palette is moving upward along with warm layers of water and then sinks back along with the cooler layers of the water. So the molten magma inside the earth moves in a similar way. When it is heated up, it is coming on the top. So as it gets the cooler wave, the warmer waves or cooler layers, they come back and sink back in the earth. So this is the movement of the magma inside the earth, a similar movement. The movement of these plates causes changes on the surface of the earth. Now what kind of changes it causes? One, you have already learned in the previous chapter that volcanic eruption, and there are two kinds of rocks. Mainly the igneous rocks are divided into extrusive and intrusive. So that you have already learned. So there is certain changes. You can see volcanic mountain on the earth surfaces. Now others we will read in this chapter. The earth movement are divided on the basis of the forces which causes them. So movements are divided on what basis? On the basis of the forces which are which causes them. The forces which act in the interior of the earth are called as endogenic forces, and the forces that work on the surface of the earth are called as exogenic forces. Like we have learned, intrusive and extrusive volcanic eruption, the one eruption which is inside the earth is called as intrusive, and one eruption which is coming on the surface of the earth is called as extrusive. Now here we are going to talk about the movement. Don't confuse between these two. This is the movement what we are talking about, and that was the eruption what we are talking about. So this movement, when it is causing inside the earth, then it is known as endogenic forces. When it is caused on the surface of the earth, then it is called as exogenic forces. Here you can see the flowchart. This you have to make in your FNB after writing down the glossary as an important notes. First you have to write down the topics of important notes, then you have to make this table also. That is compulsory. Please make it. So here already we have read that earth's movement is divided into two, that is endogenic and the exogenic. You can see here that is endogenic and the exogenic forces. Now these endogenic forces are further subdivided into two, that is sudden forces and diastrophic forces. Now what is again the sudden forces were divided into three: earthquake, volcano and landslides. These are the sudden forces. Without warning it comes. And diastrophic forces, it means building movement, building mountains, the formation of the mountains, that how the mountains are formed. So the mountains are formed in the different way, the different kind of mountains are formed in different way. So that is diastrophic forces. So endogenic forces are further divided into two, that is sudden forces and diastrophic forces. Sudden forces further divided into three, that is earthquake, volcano and landslide. And diastrophic forces is divided into one, further divided into one, that is building mountain. Now the second movement, that is known as exogenic forces. Exogenic forces is caused by two, that is erosional and depositional. It is further divided into four, that is river,
wind, sea waves, and as well as glacier. You can see over here. So this is the evolution of landform. This flow chart you can call it as. See the left hand side, lithospheric plates. As we read, there are 7 lithospheric plates. The Earth's crust consists of several large and some small, rigid, irregularly shaped plates that is also called as slabs, which carry continent and the ocean floors. Sayal and Sima, you have already learned in the previous chapter, the continental crust and as well as oceanic crust. Endogenic forces sometimes produces sudden movements and at the other times produces slow movements. Sudden movements are like earthquakes and volcano causes mass destruction over the surface of the earth. As we have seen the further division, now we are going to learn about this. The volcano. A volcano is a vent opening in the earth crust through which a molten material erupts suddenly. So where you can most probably see the vent, this is the central portion of the mountain. This is called as vent, where the magma comes out on the surface of the mountain. So vent could, it is not necessary the vent should be in center only, it could, its exterior portion could be from the side of the mountain also. It can erupt from the side also, it is not necessary it could be from the center only, but most probably there is one vent which is starting in the center. So here you can see in figure 3.2. So generally what is erupting, we have seen from the volcanic mountain, the magma is coming out. When it is coming out, it is known as lava. The top portion of this mountain, the mouth of this mountain, volcanic mountain, is called as crater. And what is erupting out from the volcanic mountain, it is not only the lava, rather than that gases and as well as ash, because everything is burning out, so ash is also erupting out from the volcanic mountain. This is the base, that is crust, and here it is mantle, from where you can find the magma chamber. Now what do you mean by endo and exo? Endo means inside and exo means outside. Genic means origin, from where it starts. So from this it formed like endogenic and exogenic. The word is formed like this. Similarly, when the lithospheric plates move, the surface of the earth vibrates. The vibration can travel all round the earth. These vibrations are called as earthquakes. The place in the earth, in the crust, where the movement starts is called as focus. The place on the surface above the focus is called as epicenter. Vibration travels outward from the epicenter as waves. Greatest damage is usually closest to the epicenter, and strength of the earthquake decreases away from the center. You can see the diagram over here, the earthquakes. So from where this vibration starts, that is called as focus. Similarly, from there at the top, from the, that center point at the top, the vibration starts on the surface of the earth. It is reaching, this vibration reach up to the surface of the earth, and the point where it starts, it's called as epicenter. As you can see over here, it is known as epicenter. Now this vibration spreads. You can see that is spreading in circular motion to outward of the focus and the epicenter. So these waves, these are called as waves. Now what kind of waves? These are called as seismic waves. So the waves in the center where the earthquake starts, the earthquake, the vibration would be more severe compared to the seismic waves, which are more further or at the furthest place. There the damages would be less. As far as this vibration moves, the furthest the vibration reaches, the destructions would be less. or damages would be less, but where it starts, the damages and destruction would found more. See the right hand side of your textbook. It is an activity. Take a container, fill it with water and close it with a lid. Put the water to boil. Now put some peas, spoons and beads on the top on the lid. What do you notice? As the water boils, the lid begins to shake. The things which you have put on the lid also vibrates. The beads roll down and the spoons vibrates to make a sound. In the same manner, the earth vibrates when the earthquake occurs. Sometimes with the earthquake's vibration, when earthquakes occur, so with the vibration, sometimes you can hear the sound also. The same thing you can find out by doing this activity at home. See the do you know portion. So there are three types of earthquake waves. One is P waves or longitudinal waves. Second is S waves or transverse waves. And third is L waves or surface waves, you can say. Now what is P waves? That is longitudinal waves. It means the, you can see over here, it stretches out and squeeze in from both. First it stretches out, then squeeze in. So because of this kind of waves, the more damage is occurred in the region. Then the next is S waves. S waves, it means the up and down movement like this. And the rocks moves up and down from side to side. They travel deep underground and cannot move through liquid. So this also creates more destruction, but it is very rare. The P waves and S waves are very rare. And the third one is the L waves. L waves, most probably these are happening in circular motion. Most earthquake damage is caused by this type of wave. So generally we are facing the L waves kind of earthquake whenever it occurs in the region. S and P waves are mostly affected in the earthquake prone area. So you have learned the two sudden movement. Although earthquake cannot be predicted, the impact can certainly minimized if we are prepared beforehand. Because earthquake is in sudden movement, as we have read already, it cannot be predicted. So we can minimize it by preparing ourselves before, as it is being faced by you people. Some common earthquake prediction methods adopted locally by the people included studying animals' behavior. Fish in the ponds get agitated, snakes comes to the surfaces. So these are the common prediction methods adopted by the local people. Generally, animals' hearing capacity is compared to human, it is more. Their ears are very sensitive, so they can hear the vibration that is being forming in the earth before the earthquake occurs. So generally the animals used to run from here and there, to and fro. They don't know where to go because of this vibration. They know suddenly something is going to happen. Fish also jumps out in the pond. They because that vibration is felt in the water body, so generally they jumps from the water body and again they dip into water, they comes out. So this movement also help out us to know that the earthquake is going to come. Snakes also, because the snakes are generally living in the burrow, so they also feel the vibration and heat and they also comes out. So this is the way, the common way to understand the earthquake is going to come. Even the birds also used to fly, though they are not living on the land, but birds also can sense the earthquake. A case study, you can see over here, earthquake hits Bhuj. Already we are from Gujarat and you know about what kind of severe earthquake was caused in Bhuj in 2000. One, a massive earthquake, you can see here, that measured 6.9 on Richter scale, hit Bhuj town on 26 January 2001. Secondly, you can say school was affected. Now, why? Because 26 January is most probably celebrated in most of the school, and teachers and children were in the school itself. So, it was affected more. At least 971 students and 31 teachers are feared to have lost their lives following the collapse of school buildings. Thirdly, Bhuj relief effort belated. 3 days after the quake, concern rose about food, blankets and medical supplies not reaching everyone. So this was the destruction. Almost every house was collapsed over there. The earth was divided into two, the surface of the earth, that was the two, a severe earthquake occurred over here. The crack you can see in the Bhuj. Fourth one, destruction of Bhuj. Phone lines, water pipelines and power stations, transmission lines were knocked out. This all were shut down because of the earthquake. Everything got destructed. Fifth, fire in the city. Hundreds of fires started as charcoal cookers overturned. This was the another tragedy that happened in the Bhuj during the earthquake. Sixth one, emergency declared in the quake zone. That is, the president declared a state of emergency because the Bhuj was considered as the epicenter. And its vibration, the seismic waves, was felt 800 kilometers away from the Bhuj. So you can just understand that how severe the earthquake was. To reach that seismic waves beyond the 800 kilometers is too much. That how severe earthquake the Bhuj was affected with. Seventh, the CM's appeal to the center, Gujarat appeal for financial help. The chief minister of Gujarat has launched an appeal for center to deal with the disaster. So here CM of Gujarat has appealed that to give financial help to the CM, whatever amount the people can pay, so the Bhuj city could be constructed again. And this happened also. Everyone got new houses, and it is now the transformed city compared to the past. But yes, the destruction was severe, that was being affected in that the Bhuj were being affected by. See the Duino portion. An earthquake is measured with a machine called a seismograph. The magnitude of the earthquake is measured on the Richter scale. An earthquake of 2.0 or less than can be felt only a little. An earthquake over 5.0 can cause damage from things falling. And a 6.0 or higher magnitude is considered very strong, and 7 is classified as the major earthquake. So the Richter scale is from 0 to 9. And the 7 is considered as the major earthquake. So here you can see the Bhuj was affected with what Richter scale of earthquake? That is 6.9. So nearer to the 7 you can say. So it was the major earthquake. The next thing, the activity that we will discuss in another video. Till then, stay tuned. Thank you.